Parkey's favourite guests from his back catalogue now on BBC Four, he meets the Hollywood heartthrob from the Valleys, Richard Burton.
Evening. Tonight we're going to recall an interview I did with Richard Burton in 1974. For me, the fascination of Burton was I never met anyone who was so effortlessly a star, and only one or two who possessed his presence. He was, like all of us, the sum of his contradictions. It was just that his were more public than most. While the purists tried to fathom why he, the greatest actor of his generation, turned his back on his great gifts, Richard Burton and his famous wife kept the world's media in a constant lather with their lavish, some said ostentatious, lifestyle, and their tempestuous, some said vulgar, love affair.
And still my heart has wings. These foolish things remind me of you. I know that this was bound to be. These things have haunted me, for you've entirely enchanted me. The sigh of midnight trains in empty stations.
49,050. Mrs. Richard Burton.
Oh, how the ghost of you clings. These foolish things remind me of you. The smile of Garbo and the scent of roses. The waiter's whistling as the last bar closes. The song that Crosby sings. These foolish things remind me of you. How strange, how sweet. The scent of smoldering leaves, the wail of steamers, two lovers on the street.
And what did she think of his acting abilities?
One of the finest actors.
One of the finest.
Sorry.
These foolish things.
20 years ago, when I interviewed Richard Burton, he was embarking upon another fresh chapter in his remarkable adventure through life. The marriage to Liz Taylor was over. He'd just spent 6 weeks in hospital fighting the booze. Yet somehow, through it all, he managed to appear, what's the word, grand. If the casual garb is a puzzle, I should explain that we did the interview in the morning before the pubs opened. We kidnapped the audience from the BBC kitchens. When Burton walked on, he was faced with 60 men in white coats. I thought I was back in that bloody clinic, he said.
Evening and welcome. My very special guest tonight was born Richard Jenkins, son of a miner in South Wales. From the humblest of beginnings, he shaped for himself a career in stage and film and became one of the world's greatest actors, as well as being one of the richest. An examination of his life gives one the distinct impression it had been written by a best-selling novelist with an unfailing eye on the film market. And if they ever do get to make the movie, they can do no better than offer the part to the man who lived that life. Ladies and gentlemen, Richard Burton. Richard, welcome. Let's talk about that background of yours, because it does interest me. I mean, the path you've come has been quite extraordinary. As I said in the introduction, you think that some novelist had written it, and if a novelist did write it, indeed, you could accuse him of over-exaggeration. Because, all right, the background, humble, comparatively so. What, in fact, did it give you, though, that background, Richard, do you think?
I think a tremendous sense of strength, I suppose. Because I presume that if you survive such a background, you must have come from an extraordinary race of people. I'm enormously proud, of course, of being Welsh.
Did you ever, when you were, when you start embarked on a career as an actor, did you ever meet any problems in that perhaps some of your mates might have thought that they'd been mixed in with a wrong one? Or so, you know what I mean? That,
not quite, no.
Well, that there's some... that there's something pansy-ish in acting as compared to mining.
Well, yes,
you do see what I'm getting at, don't you, Richard?
Yes, I do, yes. I've got the message now. The last thing you can say about me is that I'm a pansy. And I'm not a sissy.
But let's go back to where...
I do apologise to the audience, of course, for being so intensely nervous, because, you know, I don't do this kind of thing very often. And Mr. Parkinson, of course, has done it quite a lot. And so we have to...
quite a lot. Now, let's get back to Wales and the business of acting. This extraordinary voice of yours, would you say that, in fact, it's a kind of Welsh voice? Is there such a thing?
Oh, yes, it's the deep, dark answer from the valleys to everybody. I can't help... I can't help the voice. It's part of me, and I didn't cultivate it or anything. It was given to me. And I'm very lucky to possess it, I suppose.
Can we go back to something you mentioned earlier on, Dylan Thomas? Can we go back to... You're a mimic, aren't you? You can mimic most people quite accurately.
No, I can't, actually.
You can't?
No, I can do some. Yeah. I might do you, Michael, by the end of the day.
Who can you do?
Well, I can do... Laurence Olivier.
Could you?
Yes. Right now?
Please.
Now, I have to pitch my voice up a bit. Because his voice is rather higher toned than mine. So, I have to do it physically, do you mind?
No, no, that's
cool. Can you pick the camera up?
Absolutely, they'll follow you.
All right, here he comes. Richard the Third, right?
Really?
Now is the winter of our discontent, made glorious summer by this sun of York and all the clouds that lowered about our house in the deep bosom of the ocean buried.
Who else, Richard?
Well, I don't know. I don't think I'll do anybody else in case I get into trouble.
Do that marvellous... over lunch, you did the marvellous Lee Marvin one, didn't you? Which must be the other extreme.
Oh, well, yes. Well, Lee Marvin's a very strange man, and very beautiful, and very extraordinary, but he becomes, when he's had a few drinks, he's become... he becomes incoherent in the most splendid possible way. He makes a series of sounds that really takes one's breath away. Sorry, I'm not able to speak now because I'm getting incoherent the way that Lee Marvin does occasionally. And he says to, where we just did a film together in the United States, and he said to O.J. Simpson, who we know is probably the greatest athlete in the world, enormous, fantastic, splendid black man, and Lee was trying to explain to him how to act. Now, he started off all right, Lee. He was very good. Started off perfectly well, and then it degenerated. His language degenerated into kind of noises. And he said to O.J.,
you know what acting's about, do you? It's kind of... That's the way we do, baby.
You mentioned early on Dylan Thomas, too. He had a most remarkable voice, didn't he? I remember the first time I ever heard that voice. It was rather... I tell you what struck me about him, actually, was it was rather a posh voice, wasn't it?
Well, yes, he used to call himself Plus Fours and No Breakfast, or Chiffon and Cut Glass. I'll give you an example of what Dylan was like. We all had to go to a poetry reading, and I was there, and Dylan, and Dame Edith Sitwell, and Dame Edith Evans, and Louis McNeice, I've gone. It was at the Lyric Hammersmith, I remember that. And I said, John Gielgud was the overall director of the whole thing. So I said, could you get Dylan, I said, in my subtlest way, to speak Tennyson, because I know he hates Tennyson. So John arranged it so that Dylan spoke Tennyson. And the poem was, the splendor falls on castle walls and snowy summits, old in story. The long light shakes across the lakes and the wild cataract leaps in glory. Blow, bugles, blow, let the wild echoes something. And answer, echoes, answer, dying, dying, dying. And so it goes on. And the envoi is always dying, dying, dying.
So Dylan was suddenly forced to speak this poem. And so, again, you say, I can only do things physically. I have to do it, right? So he gets now, the splendor falls on castle walls and snowy summits old in story. And of course, an eternal woodbine in his mouth. Right? The long light shakes across the lakes and the wild cataracts leap in glory. Blow, bugles blow, set the wild echoes flying and answer echoes, answer, dying, dying, dying. Then he gets to the last verse. And I thought, what's he gonna do to show his absolute hatred of Tennyson? He's got to show it in the words that he says. So he gets to the last and he says, oh, love, they die on yon rich sky. They faint on hill and field and river. Their echoes roll from soul to soul and go forever and forever. Blow, bugles, blow. Set the wild echoes flying and answer echoes, answer. Dying, dying. Oh, dying.
He was ultimately, of course, a very tragic man, wasn't he?
Well, I suppose so. He sought his own death and he found it, which is not entirely tragic. He certainly wrote, of course, the most magical things. And he's alive.
Yes.
I mean, he's alive.
Yeah. Well, but one gets a sense of waste, though, surely, when you think. I mean, surely he left behind him stuff that will live forever, but he might have left more behind him.
No, I don't think so. I think he's much the same as, well, Michael, you say a sense of waste, I wouldn't quarrel with that. But I think he probably burned himself out.
He, I sort of fulfilled the notion a lot of people have about the Welsh, the Celts actually generally, about the sort of death wish that they have, the creative people. Do you, first of all, accept that they have this this kind of headlong rush toward the edge?
Yes, I think that we rather love precipices. We go towards them and withdraw now and again, temporarily. Sometimes we go over the edge.
Did you ever feel that way yourself? Have you ever felt yourself going toward the precipice and pulling back short of it?
Well, yes, I have. Yes, I think we all do, we Celts.
Would you care to tell me how? In what circumstance?
Well, there was a second or two, I think, perhaps about a year ago, when I didn't fancy much staying alive.
Really? You contemplated suicide?
Oh, no. No. No, I wouldn't kill myself in the ordinary sense of the word. I wouldn't take pills or drugs or anything really in that sense. But I did suddenly wake up one morning and found how splendidly rich and extraordinary the world was, and that I couldn't bear its richness and its beauty. And in order to obviate the idea of the richness and extraordinary beauty of the world, I thought it's best to leave it.
How do you leave it if you don't top yourself?
Oh, you can kill yourself any second. I don't mean by any obvious means. But you can, of course, can drink yourself to death.
Mm-hmm.
And that's very, rather pleasant.
It's better than falling on a sword. That's for sure.
Yeah, well, at least...
Is that what you tried to do, to drink yourself to death?
I had a go, yeah.
Did you?
Yeah.
And how acute did this become? And what amount of drinking?
Oh, pretty bad, pretty bad. Because the doctor in California, I was in California, said that if I kept on as I was going, I only had 2 weeks to live, which was rather fascinating, because when you examine the idea of 2 weeks, every second, every minute, every hour, every day, 2 weeks only, I was absolutely fascinated. I wasn't frightened at all, but fascinated. Because I thought, here we go again, boys. We're on the edge of a terrible precipice. Anyway, I decided to withdraw from the precipice, which I have done.
How difficult was it, having embarked on this business of drinking? I mean, how heavily were you drinking?
Oh, I was up to... I was a champion.
Were you?
If you pardon my using a Yorkshire word.
Booze for Wales, could you?
No, I was up to, I'm told, about, because of course you don't remember if you drink that much, I was up to about 2.5 to 3 bottles of hard liquor a day, which is a lot.
It's the truth. I like drinking, but I think that might, I mean, I think one day that might blow my head off. But, I mean, that would mean then that you must, obviously, to drink that amount, you must have started in the morning at breakfast.
Oh, you start at midnight. And you keep on through midnight. And you go on and on and on. Nobody's going to, you don't eat. You don't do anything very much except drink. Fascinating idea, of course. The idea of drink on that scale. It's rather nice to have gone through it and to have survived. We all know that we're going towards an inevitable doom. It's rather interesting to deliberately go towards and then withdraw. Because nobody else has been there and withdrawn. But I've been there. I've seen that dark wood. I know how terrible it is, how frightful it is, and how frightening it is. But I went there and came back.
What did you see when you were there?
Oh, well, I don't know. Very difficult to say, you see, because if you're that blind drunk, you don't know what's happening. Do you? I saw all kinds of monstrosities. I mean, trying to get some food into my mouth was extraordinary business, you know, because I was in a Roman Catholic hospital called St. John's in Santa Monica, and they said, you must eat, and I said, don't want to eat. Must eat. Don't want to. You must. All right, give me the food. What do you want? And I said, Jell-O, which is the American word for jelly. And they brought it in. It was very soft. And it was a Roman Catholic hospital, and so I insisted that I fed myself. And I got the spoon with careful application into this thing. Shall we say it was like this, right? Which, by the way, is water.
I can testify to that. BBC water, too.
So I get the thing in, and I'm about to take it to my mouth, but of course my hands won't obey me. Right? They fly all over the place. And a friend of mine who was there said, well, I know, Richard, that you're in a Roman Catholic hospital. There's no need to do the sign of the cross every time you eat. It was like this.
What in fact brought you back? Took you back from the edge?
Oh, I think a kind of defiance. I refuse to die. Now, I may drop dead this second, for all we know, but at least I'm not inviting it.
No, no. Can we talk for a short while about the circumstances that led up to that? I don't want to pry into your private life at all, because I wouldn't like mine inspecting, none of us would. Except, of course, that you led such a public private life, didn't you?
Indeed, yes.
That you were married to Liz Taylor. And that, I take it, is the point that you were referring to that caused this this problem in your life. Can we go back to that marriage that you had? I don't know, it always seemed to me to be an extraordinarily unlikely liaison.
Well, it obviously was, because we divorced. No, it was nothing to do with Elizabeth, who was a very sweet and generous and gentle person. It would have happened anyway. I mean, my particular driving myself would have happened anyway. Nothing to do with her at all. Of course, she was... you don't marry people easily, as you know. It's always difficult. And indeed, in my particular life with Elizabeth, it was a very public one. You could hardly belch without the world knowing about it. And we belch quite frequently. As a matter of fact, she's one of the champion belchers in the world. I'm very fond of her, but it was actually nothing to do with Elizabeth, so you mustn't blame her for that.
It wasn't?
No, no.
Can you give me some indication of how unprivate your life was? I mean, how much you became a prisoner because of the credible publicity that followed you wherever you went?
Well, it was very difficult, I suppose, in many ways, except that I never paid much attention to the publicity. It really is a bit boring when you
get up in the morning and you go out for a walk or whatever it is, and there are three photographers or whatever it is, or one or none, which is even worse than many. If they're not there, you scream, and if they're there, you scream. But of course, it gives you, of course, a great many other things. You are a very privileged person. You have riches and wealth. You have the best seat in a restaurant. You have the best seat on a plane. You're treated like a kind of demigod, which is not a bad idea, for me anyway. But certainly not a good idea for your own ego.
But she was a very different animal to you, wasn't she, in the sense that she'd been brought up since a very tender age to this kind of star treatment. And I go back again to your origins, which are entirely, absolutely different. And therefore, wouldn't it be likely that she was more able to cope with this kind of situation than you?
I'm not sure. But Elizabeth used to have a kind of private veil that she put on in public, where she didn't seem to notice photographers or journalists or whatever. She walked through them all as if through a vacuum. And I saw the private person as well, but the public one certainly was aloof and enormously difficult to break. She was absolutely strange kind of... I don't know how to describe her. I lived with her too long. 13 years is a long time.
Yes. What about the, what some people might regard the ostentatious show of wealth that went with your relationship? It was as if it seemed that here was the boy from Wales who suddenly found the world's biggest diamond and said, you know, it's mine. I mean, was there something almost as childlike as that in it?
Yes, I'm afraid so. The diamond that you talk about, once I heard that it was the largest, most flawless diamond in the world, naturally I had to buy it, if I could. It took me a long time to buy it, but I got it. I don't know why I got it, not absolutely, but I had to get it. So, in a sense, that I may have been extraordinarily corrupted by my background and the things that happened to me afterwards. And I think everybody is, regardless of how self-slighting they may be. I think that the world was possibly too much with me.
How do you mean, too much with you?
Oh, too much, surrounded by too much. Ever since I can remember. First of all, my brothers and sisters were all extraordinarily nice to me, and also I think I looked at the world in a very oblique way. And certainly that kind of ostentation, private airplanes, diamonds, pearls, women, was obviously not the kind of thing that one would expect from somebody like me. But it happened. Don't know why, but it happened.
Did you like Hollywood?
Oh, yes. Yes, it's a very nice place. I'm going there in a minute anyway, so I have to say it's nice, isn't it? No, it's very nice. It's a fantastic suburb. Has no center, no route. It goes on and on and on. Nothing but swimming pools and tennis courts and very rich people, very nice people too, I may say, at least to me. But not, it doesn't have any kind of route, some funny way.
Mm. And of course, when you went to Hollywood, I mean, you met another man who I assume might have been a hero of yours when you were watching movies, and that was Bogart.
Oh, yes.
You share my admiration for him.
Oh, yes, very much.
Yeah. Yeah,
great friend of mine. And
a man I'd love to have interviewed.
You never interviewed him? You never met him?
No, never.
Oh, what a shame. Mind you, you'd have had trouble with him. He wasn't easy, I can tell you that.
Was he not?
Oh, no, very difficult man. But if you understood him, and if you liked him, if you loved him as I did, enchanting. But he frightened people to death.
Did you ever have the urge to do something outrageous when you were in Hollywood?
Oh, yes. Yes, it frequently happened. I did do all kinds of extraordinary things there. Over the years, of course, I've been back and forth there for 25 years, 30 years. Now, I did some very extraordinary things. I kicked a set down one day.
A set?
A set, yes, a whole set. And as far as I remember, Olivia de Havilland was on top of it.
Was that just out of a paddy, was it?
Well, I couldn't remember the lines of this particular speech I was doing with Olivia de Havilland. I had to climb up a wall, and she was at the top. And I had to say, I've forgotten what I had to say. Well, I forgot then. certainly can't remember now. And I had to climb up this sort of drain pipe and everything, and a lot of stuff. And I could not remember the lines. There's always one scene, you know, in any picture that you where you have difficulty with the words. So I climbed up once, slithered down in a temper because I'd forgotten the lines. Went up again, slithered down. Went up again, slithered down. Went up again. I must have gone up about 10 times or something like that. And finally I went raving mad and started to kick the set, and the whole thing started to fall in. And I was very clever to get out of the way. Mr. Havilland didn't forgive me for a long time.
I had Julie Andrews on the programme, and she was talking about the boredom of doing a long run. And she said that you, as a kind of exercise, used to come out and play the same line in different ways, that one night you'd play it for laughs, the same line, and the next night you'd play it for tears, and that whichever way you did it, the audience reacted to you.
I do remember doing some very peculiar things on the stage. For instance, I was playing Hamlet once in New York, and I have a daughter called Maria Burton. And at that time, she's German. She's adopted by Elizabeth and myself. But the Germans, being very proper and legal and so on, wanted to make sure that I was a suitable father for the child. So they all came to New York to see me and see where I lived. I live in a hotel, so I don't know why they wanted to see the hotel, but anyway, they came. And all five, six, or seven of them, I've forgotten what, were all sitting in front. And I came on to speak to be or not to be. And in the meantime, Elizabeth had said, now, whatever you do, Richard, be nice to the Germans. And I said, of course I will be. But, you know, there is a slight kind of tiny ache in the bones about the Germans.
You sound like Churchill now.
I think, yes. So anyway, I came on the stage and I said, instead of saying to be or not to be, that is the question and so on, I said, sein oder nicht sein, das ist die Frage. Ups, Edelingen, die Pfeil und Schleudern. And so I went on with to be or not to be. And the Germans were delighted, but Polonius and Claudius, who were standing behind an arras, went raving mad, because they thought I'd gone raving mad.
Did you find that you did, when you look back on your career in films and on stage, that you got your most self-rewarding sense from stage rather than film?
Certainly in my case, I see absolutely no difference between the two. There is, of course, a quieter technique, which is easy for anybody to get, assuming that you can act. And that, as a matter of fact, Elizabeth taught me a great deal, by telling me, but by simply by doing it. I think she's one of the world's greatest screen actors.
Really?
Oh, yes. I think she's absolutely magnificent. But she, I did a scene with her one day in, I've forgotten the film. And I said, she doesn't do anything. What's she doing? And a mutual friend said, go and see her tomorrow on the rushes. And I went to see her and she was doing everything.
Quality of stillness, almost, is it?
Well, yes, I suppose, but no, things are happening behind those eyes, you know. Mm. Something's happening in the brain. And so you have to try and catch that yourself, I mean. Yes. After all, I get paid a lot of money for acting. So you try to find out how to get that same quality. I don't think I will ever get it because I'm too loud and I'm too strong.
There is a marvelous story I know about you playing Hamlet and Churchill being in the audience. Right. See, O'Toole came on the programme, sitting where you are now, and said that the trouble with doing to be or not to be is that everybody joins in.
You found this to be true, and certainly I know.
Well, it certainly was true in Sir Winston's case because he came to Hamlet and he sat in the front row of the Old Vic because there's no royal box there. And he sat with his wife and detectives or whatever they were. And I came on the stage feeling absolutely diabolical. But I was told that the old man was in front. Of course, there was only one old man. And I came on the stage and I started to speak first line's family, a little more than kin and less than kind. And I heard this extraordinary rumble from the front row of the stalls. And I wondered what it was. I thought, have I got a hangover? What's going on? And it was Sir Winston. He wasn't Sir Winston then, he was just Winston. Speaking the lines with me, and I could not shake him off, whatever I did, wherever I went, to be or not to be, he was with me to the death, every word. And I don't know quite what he was trying to do. I suppose he was rather upset that he wasn't on stage. And it was really quite extraordinary. Oh, what a rogue and peasant slave am I, for instance, with Sir Winston joining you in a duet. It's not the easiest thing in the world. Bloody, bawdy villain, literalist, treacherous, remorseless, kindless villain. Oh, vengeance and
Did he come backstage to see you?
Yes, he did, yes. He came in the interval backstage, and he went back, actually, to see the rest of the performance, and he came back, and I thought he'd gone home, because I watched through the spy hole at the Old Vic, and it seemed, oh, well, I said, we've lost him. He's gone. And so I thought I might as well have a drink then. Since he's gone, get sloshed. So I sat in the dressing room, and I was just about to put a whiskey and soda to my mouth when, and the door was open, and suddenly in the door was Sir Winston, and he bowed very graciously, and very courteously said, "My Lord Hamlet, may I use your lavatory?"
Which of the films that you made, of all the many films that you made, are you proudest of? Which do you like the best of all?
I don't know, really. I think there are about six or seven that I've made, which is pretty bad batting average. But I'd say half a dozen that I think are rather good.
What about Beckett?
I think that's all right. Yeah.
We've got a clip actually of Beckett, which I'd like to show to you, if you can roll through to that, which I think sort of somehow sums up what you were talking about, this sort of stillness. It's the final scene where Beckett is...
Do I have to watch it, Mike?
Well, can't you bear to watch it?
Well, I'll try, just for you.
Your Grace, there are armed men at the doors. I've bolted the doors, but...
Desmond bolt the doors during Vespers? I've never heard of it.
But, Your Grace...
Open them. Everything must be as it should be for divine service.
Deus in adjutorium meum intende.
One does not carry arms into God's house. What do you want?
Your death.
It's fairly powerful stuff, isn't it?
Yeah. Very badly acted.
Do you think it was badly acted?
Oh, yes. I could do much better if you asked me to do it now, which I won't, of course.
What was wrong with it?
I could hear one word that was absolutely terribly wrong. One word, yes. That nobody comes into the house of God during divine service. Now, why did I say divine, not divine service, which is the perfectly obvious thing to say? That's where I overacted, you see. Nevertheless, it got away. I mean, nobody noticed it.
I should have, yes, I'm going to say it. You want people standing up in cinema screaming, why did he say divine? I'm sure.
Well, why shouldn't they?
Why shouldn't
they? They should, like a bad menu.
You think so?
Yes.
Noel Coghill once said that he'd only ever taught two people of genius, you and W.H. Auden. Do you think that you've lived up to his expectations?
No, I'm afraid not.
Was it an impossible one to live up to?
However, it's a very nice thing for him to say. Now, whether I've lived up to his prognostication, or whatever the word is, I certainly don't know. I shan't know for a long time. But certainly I will try to be what he asked me to be, what he thought I was.
There is time left?
Oh, yes. Oh, good 30 years, I fancy.
30 years?
Yeah, I'll be back on this program endlessly.
When you look back, Richard, at this extraordinary life that you've had, can you really believe that it's happened to you? I mean, are you constantly filled with a sense of wonder?
Well, that I never lose. Sense of wonder is really... if one loses that, one loses everything. So everything is a slight miracle.
Richard Burton died in 1984 of a cerebral hemorrhage. He was 58. The actor Anthony Quayle said of him, "He wasn't that concerned in contributing to great art or anything. He was concerned with the odyssey of Richard Burton, and that's what made him such a fascinating man." And that he certainly was. Next week, I'll be remembering meetings with Frankie Howard and Tommy Cooper. This week, I leave you with Richard Burton's party piece from our interview in 1974. Good night.
We have before us an ordeal of the most grievous kind. I will say to the house, I have nothing to offer but blood, toil, tears, and sweat. You ask, what is our policy? I will say, it is to wage war. To wage war by sea, land, air, with all our might and with all the strength that God can give us. To wage war against a monstrous tyranny never surpassed in the dark, lamentable catalogue of human crime. That is our policy. You ask, what is our aim? I can answer in one word: victory. Victory at all costs. Victory in spite of all terror. Victory however long or hard the road may be. For without victory, there is no survival. We are resolved to destroy Hitler and every vestige of the Nazi regime. From this, nothing will turn us, nothing. We will never parley, we will never negotiate with Hitler or the grisly gang that feeds his wicked will. We shall fight him by sea, we shall fight him in the air, until, with God's help, we have rid the earth of his shadow.